So welcome to the third video in our series, Giraffe for Practitioners. In the first video, we talked about blueprinting and the importance of blueprinting, and also we talked about the product market fit. In the last video, we actually went around Giraffe and kind of navigated parts of Giraffe.
Showed you where things are.
Right, and so in this video, we're gonna be talking now about the inner workings of Giraffe, mm-hmm. because you do hear things like drivers. Like, we know what drivers are when we're building business models, but how do they actually translate into Giraffe? So global drivers, custom tables.
Yeah, and it's key to kind of know this nomenclature as you go through, so that as you're talking to whether it's the client, internal analysts, etc., everyone's kind of on the same term, because what means drivers in Giraffe can mean something elsewhere. So I'll share another video with going through the drivers, global drivers. Really, it's the basic fundamental building blocks of how you build the model.
So in this video, inner workings of Giraffe, we will be touching on not just like some of the nomenclature and where things are at, the inner workings, but also some of the best practices, especially keeping an eye towards cash accounts, the cash flow statement, ensuring that chart of accounts are categorized correctly, how to title things, best practices around
remapping, driver nomenclature, etc.
Good. Looking forward to it. Hey everyone, thanks again for watching. You know, if you're enjoying this, please do me a favor. Like it, comment, and subscribe. Appreciate it.
In this video, we're going to be going through two main pieces of Giraffe. First, we're going to go through some best practices on some of the back-end settings. As you may have seen in the previous video, we talked through kind of navigating where the back-end settings are. Today, we're going to give some best practices on them that we've learned over the past few years. Second, we're going to be going through some drivers, basically what they are, how they work, some different variations of them, and how they begin to actually flow into the model. So first, once again, as a recap, we're going to navigate over to this back-end setting. I'm going to start with the company setup first. So in the company setup, this is going to be one of the main things that we focus on setting up before you actually do any of the forecasting. As you saw in the previous video, we're going to start by uploading the actuals. Once you upload the actuals, we're going to head over to here, this company setup, and begin building it out. So starting from the top, you'll have the ability to upload the company logo, company name if you need to change that for whatever reason, and then down to the accounting section. So in the accounting section, the two main things that you're going to want to look at is the QuickBooks import and the close month. This model actually has QuickBooks, but if you use Xero, NetSuite, the settings that you're going to want to select are pretty much the same. So for the close month, you would think that you would want to select QuickBooks close month. However, our best practice is to actually select the specific date and on a case-by-case basis, come in and change this out to whatever you need to use this for. So for this scenario, the reason why we don't want to use the automatic close date is because Giraffe doesn't define a close date until it's actually been locked in QuickBooks. And as you all know, oftentimes the accounting team may go back and actually update historical months, whether that's accrual issues, some changes in items that need to be addressed. And so not all the time do you actually lock down the books. And in that case, that won't happen to actually roll forward with this option selected. That's why we want to choose the specific date. Now, it does cause you to have to go in on a monthly basis and update this date. But once again, I think that's an easier piece to actually change than what may transpire with the automatic selection. Going down, I'm going to skip over some of these because some of these are pretty standard selections. I want to pinpoint some of the ones that you should be aware of. So for salaries expense, what this technically is all of your wages when you bring them in, whether it's hard coding the new hires in or doing an upload via Gusto or Excel, you have to select one wage account. The reason being is because you haven't mapped out where each wages go, right? Some companies have all of them under one account in OPEX, other have them broken out between OPEX for sales and marketing, RevOps, corporate versus admin, etc., and some may go to COGS. So Giraffe has you select one main account that you then map from there. So don't worry that there's only one selection, that's the reason why. We'll do some mapping later. In terms of assets, this is where you select your cash functionality. In this case, 99 times out of 100, you're gonna wanna select just your plain old operating account. You may have a savings account or some money markets or some other accounts that you also, the customer may have. But in this scenario, just select the main operating accounts. You'll be able to allocate cash between those accounts down the road once we get into the planning feature. But this is going to be where your cash movements from your P&L and balance sheet by standard flow through. For AR and AP, two more big pieces here. Usually, I don't like to select one. I like to have it the standard, open option. The reason being is because let's take AR, right? Let's take an e-commerce business. That e-commerce business may have direct-to-consumer as well as wholesale. If you're an e-commerce business, that direct-to-consumer sales are usually COD, right? Cash on delivery, net zero, customer pays before the order actually even gets processed. And you may want to segment that to impact cash as a net zero impact versus your wholesale, which may be, net 60, even maybe net 90 or net 45, right? If you select one of these items here and select the AR delay, that applies it as a global metric across all of your sales, whereby you may actually want to segment based on the underlying detail. Same situation with accounts payable, a little bit more functionality in terms of which accounts you're actually doing the accrual for. But if you want to segment based on specific items, that's where you're not going to want to select some of these immediate selections that you would otherwise think to. Otherwise, this is the building blocks that you have to set up before you move on to the actual planning piece of it. Now, I'm going to head over to the planning section, a little bit preeminent, but roll over to this planning section and talk a little bit about drivers. So drivers in this case, we can use a lot of different nomenclature, but drivers in Jirav, think of them as formulas, right? Now the formulas may be just a one-to-one mapping of something, or they may be an actual multivariate, multiplication, subtraction, addition, division. So for drivers, you have basic drivers and you have global drivers. Oversimplified, basic drivers are just going to be in the plan that you are working in. Global drivers are going to span all of the plans that you have active. Now the difference is you have also a couple different drivers that you're able to build. Annual targets, fixed spreads, growth on historicals, periodic, amount per headcount, percentage of other, and custom. Most of the time you're going to find yourselves using this custom. Why? Because this custom can be mapping from a custom table to your P&L revenue account or balance sheet accounts, which we'll dive into in a later video on these custom tables, or maybe leveraging an assumption. You may have built out your assumptions at the bottom and want to map them, right? You may have an assumption on your average selling price. You may have your units in a custom table and you want to multiply the two and pull it up into revenue. That is going to be using the custom driver. Once again, you'll have the selection of choosing which departments you want to assign that to, if your company does use departments. If not, we'll just use the basic unassigned. And this is where you have the inputs. You have the selection of selecting anything from the P&L, the balance sheet, staffing, custom tables. You can still do some of those periodic drivers, growth rates and whatnot, by using a custom driver. It just simplifies it by if you select that growth on historicals in that first box. In this case, you can choose the custom table, which sales table you want to use, say it's new MRR per month, and just pull that directly into your P&L. I'm going to pause there. There's a lot more that we're going to go through to kind of connect these dots. Don't be worried if you are not familiar with the custom tables yet. One of our upcoming videos is actually going to share with you how these custom tables work and how you can leverage them to build out your P&L and balance sheets. Looking forward to it. Drop us a comment if you have any questions.
That was great. So thanks for watching. Please subscribe. Leave us some feedback. Also, check out our website, growthlabfinancial.com. Again, subscribe so you can be notified for the next one.